The link in the description is only there to see the source material. Do not under any circumstance go to these people with the intent to be a dick. I don't support witch hunts or lynch mobbing, so don't be either. As for the subjects themselves, my video is for the purposes of criticism and entertainment. Take it or leave it. My content is not here to start drama. Please do not treat it like it is.
I'll have to say, Squirt, you put up quite the fight. Never knew you had it in you. Perhaps when I claim this ship as my own, we can be sparring partners.
What even is your goal? Why are you doing this?
Why? Oh, well, that's a good question, really. I suppose it's because I hate how this place is ran. We only have one version of each of us from an arbitrary organization created by someone who's not even on the ship anymore, mind you, to box themselves into some useful goal on the ship without realizing that their own arbitrary nature would make them useful to each other. We can make a fucking society of uses that play off of each other and know how to work off of each other's strength to make us the most powerful group in the godforsaken multiverse. Is that good enough reason for you?
Well, just how do you plan to do that when we have you all tied up?
Who says I'm tied up? We do. What? So every now and then I get asked what my opinions are of a user by the name of Miss Anthropony, and normally I don't have an answer. I still don't really. However, I was linked a video on him by this commentator called Zesty Bomb, and I have thoughts. And the context is Space Jam 2, which Miss Anthro is reviewing. This is the messiest context I've given to a video? Probably. However, I've watched the entire movie for this commentary, so you can bet I'm covering it anyway. Roll it.
And unfortunately, it's all downhill from there. I think you guys are already familiar with the most obvious problem with the movie, so let's save that for later and try to focus on other things. For starters, it's extremely predictable and cliche. It's just the usual story about the underdogs going against the bigleagues, and they don't do anything interesting or all that different. The way they go about it just feels very formulaic and cluttered. One of the more cluttered parts of the movie is definitely the montage of Jinx and Bugs traveling to all these different Warner Brother worlds to gather the Looney Tunes
characters. The problem with this montage is that it's really boring and clearly in the movie for no other reason than to shove a bunch of Warner Brother properties in your face. I mean, why exactly did we have to travel to all of these worlds just for the sake of it? It's so painfully obvious that it's here just because Warner Brothers wants to have a montage of popular franchises they own.
The reason why that scene was in the movie, the montage, it was because LeBron and Bugs were trying to look for the other Looney Tunes. You can't just assume that Warner Brothers put it in the movie because they wanted to put product placement in the movie. That's not a good critique. That's like saying Pikmin 2 is a bad game because it has product placement in said game that you collect as treasure to bring back to your ship.
Counterpoint, the way Pikmin 2 does it isn't as in your face or blatant about it as much as Space Jam 2 is, because all the product placement in Pikmin is in the form of objects you collect that you'll most of the time only notice as a little nod, a little Easter egg at best. Whereas in Space Jam, not only are all these references strictly important to the setting of the movie, considering the movie takes place in what is in essence the Warnerverse, but they're also incredibly blatant about it by shoving it into your face every chance they got. So the two critiques would ultimately be vastly different considering the point of both settings. You could ultimately have Pikmin without the product placement, whereas Space Jam 2 would not be the same movie without its references. So that said, while I personally have my disagreements with just how abundant and annoying the references are, Miss Anthropony's critique of them being everywhere isn't a problem, as he otherwise finds them to be more of a nuisance. Furthermore, even if he just has a problem with product placement and references, what if he also has a problem with Pikmin's product placement? You give us really no actual rebuttal towards the critique itself, just towards the reason for the critique being the claim that it wasn't there for any real reason, to which I will give you kudos for.
Do you see how that argument doesn't work, Map? Because it doesn't, and you should know. I played Pikmin 2. Get wrecked! Yo.
You sure did. Own him with those facts and logic of a game we don't even know Miss Anthropony played. Much less liked. Seriously, this whole bit of extra condescension wasn't particularly needed.
But perhaps they can work around how bad the acting is if the story is good, right? Well, it's not. The subplot with James and his son having a hard time connecting is extremely rushed and not given nearly enough time to properly develop. Obviously, they wanted to make the movie more character-focused, but the character they go for is extremely forced. In the original, Michael Jordan was presented as an everyman. It was one of the few things in the original Space Jam that worked because of how believable his character was. He was grounded and down to earth, and the movie focuses on his life after retirement from basketball, spending quality time with his family and exploring new interests. They didn't need to come up with this phoned-in subplot about him being an overbearing parent. The way they try to establish the conflict between James and his son is very poor and not at all believable. And when you get down to it, it doesn't even make any sense.
Why would LeBron James want his kids to be basketball players like him? Why wouldn't he want them to pursue different interests? Does he think of basketball as a family tradition that needs to be upheld? There's little to no chemistry between James and his son throughout the whole movie, to the point that there's no reason to feel invested in it. And by the time they get to the scene where James says he's sorry and his son forgives him and they share a big hug and everyone in the crowd cheers for them, you just don't care. It's supposed to be this really emotional moment, but there was no proper build-up to it, and it feels like the movie is just trying way too hard.
I will agree with you that the build-up with LeBron and his son making up is a bit rushed and comes out of nowhere. However, in the opening scene, it was established why LeBron takes basketball very seriously and why he's wanting his sons to follow in his footsteps, even if they don't want to. I don't know if you were paying attention, but you can't just spread misinformation in front of your audience. Doing so is not a good thing. And at worst, it can make you look like a huge liar. And you really don't want that, do ya?
Man, this point was botched. You start by agreeing with Miss Anthropone's critique regarding the father-son relationship being rushed, but then just kind of push that to the side because there was an undiscerned reason for that being the case. You never elaborate on it, you just say that there is a reason for it, and that's why he's lying? Which also doesn't make any sense, because the whole critique here was that LeBron and his son's conflict felt forced, given that there wasn't really enough time to build upon it that would give an audience member any reason to give a fuck. And the reason we do get, in Miss Anthro's opinion, is poorly done and doesn't really make a lot of sense considering how forced the chemistry between them was, which you already agreed with. Hello?
Yes. Oh, and they actually had the nerve to tease us with a possible cameo from the actual Michael Jordan just to show that it was Michael B. Jordan instead. The one thing that a lot of fans of the original were looking forward to, and you couldn't even give us that. Even knowing they weren't actually going to get MJ for this movie, it still feels really scummy that they deliberately got people's hopes up for the sake of a half-assed joke.
Do you have any proof that Warner Brothers straight up lied to people about not getting Michael Jordan into the Space Jam sequel? I'm really questioning if you have any proof, because we don't know.
What we do know is that Sylvester went out looking for a Michael Jordan for the climax of the movie, and when claiming that he found him, there was a long enough build-up to the punchline that ultimately was, oh, this isn't that Michael. But as far as promotional stuff goes, you can thank Don Cheadle for that one, because he was the one that blabbed in an interview that Michael Jordan will make an appearance, just, quote, not in the way you'd think, which is horribly misleading, and they knew it. To be honest, that does seem a little like getting people's hopes up for what was ultimately a subjectively subpar payoff. And I only say subjectively because I thought it was funny myself, though I'm not here to give my opinion on the movie.
We don't know what went on behind the scenes. Like, maybe, oh, I don't know. Wait until a DVD release comes out. That way we can confirm this stuff for ourselves. I know you are looking into this stuff very critically with a critical eye, but it would be a good idea to at least wait for a DVD release for some insight on what went on behind the scenes. Just saying.
This literally wouldn't matter either, Zesty. Miss Anthropone is critiquing the promise of Michael Jordan that we are able to see regardless of the behind-the-scenes information in both movie and promotional interviews. All waiting for a DVD release would do is just allow us to see the behind-the-scenes. That wouldn't change the critiques of the movie.
Oh, and did I mention there's a lot of cringe-inducing content in this movie? The forced memes, the forced pop culture references, the fact they made James do that stupid dab, the fact they made Granny say haters gonna hate, and the fact they resorted to that stupid Matrix parody that got old years ago. It wasn't even original when Shrek did it. Yeah, it's a Warner Brothers property. That doesn't make it any less forced. The only way this could possibly get any more cringe-inducing is if they had a sequence of Porky Pig getting into a rap battle.
And just with one bar, most famous of all quotes, this battle is now over. That's all, folks.
I hate this fucking timeline. I just hate it so much.
So, you hate this timeline because they decided to put a scene with Porky Pig getting into a rap battle. Get to know.
Should I tell them that this was most likely a play-up of anger towards the movie and isn't actually supposed to be seen as a legitimate statement? I'll play it straight for the sake of a point, just in case I'm wrong. No, Zesty, Porky Pig rapping isn't the crux of why Misanthro hates this timeline. It's the overabundance of corporate cringy memes and modern references that are going to be dated in a few years' time. And seeing Hollywood persist to use these trends as substitution for quality content combined with the Star Wars sequel trilogy, the Lion King live-action remake being a worldwide success, and the release of Cuties, that would ultimately lead to a statement such as, I hate this timeline. Porky would merely be but the straw that broke the pony's back. That said, I want to critique Misanthropony here. Yo, my home slice, we really out here using cringy as a legitimate critique of a movie in our Lord and Savior 2021? Really? Because that's some weak sauce reviewing, my guy. Not only because cringy is such a vague descriptor that's only really used as a catch-all term to describe things you don't like, but it also basically carries no substance behind it. Like, sure, there is merit to critiquing the memes and jokes in this movie being practically instantly dated. I can see someone taking issue with that as it really shows a level of pandering to what corporate thinks children would enjoy and screams desperation to be relevant while sacrificing its integrity. Fine, that would be valid. I would disagree, but whatever, there would be merit to it. But cringy isn't a critique, it's a reaction to discomfort.
Also, why are you bringing up Cuties, the Star Wars sequel trilogy, and the Lion King remake? All three of those things aren't relevant anymore, so stop bringing them up in every single one of your videos, and just move on already. Please.
The point of the anger he's demonstrated here is due to the fact our timeline let them happen at all. Whether or not Misanthro generally detests these things, or is merely playing up his anger to be as entertaining as he can be, the crux of these examples is that they happened at all, to which he feels shouldn't have been the case. That said, though, at least one of these examples was literally just last year, and the other two examples of the Star Wars sequel trilogy and the Lion King remake are vague enough in this video to have some other underlying reason behind Misanthro's anger towards them.
I'm sure you've probably heard this from a lot of people by now, but I'm really not a fan of the live-action remakes currently dominating Disney's production. Not because they're the worst and most horribly written movies that Disney has ever put out, far from it, but the real problem with these remakes is that they represent an increasing sense of laziness going on at the company. Now that they're hell-bent on turning the entertainment industry into a monopoly, their main focus seems to be making as much money as possible each year. Now, this isn't normally a bad thing, obviously. Companies need money in order to operate, but when it comes at the expense of any form of artistic integrity, there comes a time where you really just need to stop and think about what you're doing to your image.
You can't just say view these movies as their own thing because they're not supposed to be seen as their own thing. It's called the sequel trilogy for a reason. The Force Awakens, The Last Jedi, and The Rise of Skywalker. All of them are supposed to be smaller parts of a greater whole. Star Wars isn't just some franchise. It's the biggest and most important franchise in all of media. Its massive scope is still being discussed across the board because it is the staple of Western media. It invented every trick in the book in terms of world building, lore, big scale storytelling, character deconstruction. There are millions of parodies and spoofs of it specifically because of how great an influence it had in the 70s and 80s alone. It revolutionized so many storytelling tools and techniques we still use today. It's the golden example for why the it's just a movie, or it's just a video game, or it's just a cartoon, or it's a work of fiction that isn't real so it's not worth getting upset and angry over excuse is a terrible dismissal of criticism. It changed the very foundation of filmmaking and inspired millions of people worldwide. No other franchise in the history of media can ever hope to wield even a candle to it. It was ahead of its time in so many ways, and the sequel trilogy completely disregards that entirely in favor of empowering women, intersectional politics, and horribly thought-out plot twists that amount to nothing but lazy shock value. It's completely disrespectful to such an important legacy. And that's not even including the plot holes.
These are reasons that Misanthro could have had towards why he'd keep making references at these things that would transcend exactly how long ago these things were. Since you leave it at they're not relevant anymore without explaining how the age of these situations prevent them from being relevant, it comes across as your only point of contempt being how long ago these examples were, and not really much past that. And when Misanthro's complaints come down to how these situations spotlight a much more persistent and problematic issue with the state of Hollywood, you're gonna have to try much harder than that.
How did the Looney Tune world get transported from the center of the Earth into cyberspace? How did the AI create the new Looney Tunes world? Did he abduct them and throw them into the computer? Do the Toons not care they're suddenly in a computer? There's no logical consistency to this at all.
Did you really go into this movie expecting it to have good writing? Because, do they really need to explain all that? No, this is it's just a stupid kids movie that's just trying to have fun with this dumb concept. And sometimes, having some stupid fun is what you need. I mean, the original Space Jam got away with it, so why can't this movie get away with it?
Wow, that's a point, I guess? First and foremost, this play is so laughably dismissive of the criticisms Misanthro has towards the movie, because regardless of if it's a kid's movie or not, it's still prone to criticism, which is kind of the point of Misanthro's entire video. Furthermore, the problem here comes into the fact that this is a sequel to the original Space Jam, and the Toons have been moved from the center of the Earth into a cyberverse, which is inconsistent with what the original Space Jam had established. This has nothing to do with how silly or fun the writing is, it has everything to do with the inconsistent disconnect between the two movies, which a kid's film could still have. See, most Disney sequels, or Shrek.
And I know you've all been waiting for me to talk about this, so let's talk about the biggest problem with the movie. It's a giant Warner Brothers circle jerk. If you hated the product placement in the original Space Jam, this movie will give you a fucking heart attack. Every second of this movie is constantly shoving shameless plugins to other Warner properties down your throat in a desperate tactic to sell you something. Oh, and it's not like they only feature a handful of their more iconic IPs as a clever nod. Oh no, they throw the entire goddamn library at you. Game of Thrones, Harry Potter, The Wizard of Oz, The Matrix, Casablanca, Scooby-Doo, The Jetsons, The Flintstones, Batman, Superman, Wonder Woman, The Justice League, The It Reboot, The Animaniacs, Thundercats, Space Ghost, The Iron Giant, The Mask, King Kong, A Clockwork Orange, Mad Max, Austin Powers, Rick and Morty, the entire lineup of Hanna-Barbera cartoons, and many others that I don't have time to mention. Even for Space Jam, this movie is insultingly corporate. You can't go a single moment in this film without constantly being reminded you're watching a Warner Brothers movie. Hell, you can't even make the argument that they're self-aware because this movie has no self-awareness whatsoever. There's literally a scene where they make fun of uninspired corporate synergy bullshit and then immediately forget how that's a bad thing and proceed to flood the narrative with it. They make fun of how hiring sports athletes for your movie is a terrible idea and a cheap cash grab, and then spend the next 60 minutes force-feeding you how fucking awesome LeBron James is. Fuck, when James lands in the Toon World, they literally show you the Nike symbol where
he lands. You seriously couldn't resist doing that for even a second? And I know, it looks like I'm making a big deal out of this, like I'm supposed to be surprised.
That's because you are making a big deal out of it. Like, you're just spending the entire segment complaining about Warner Brothers throwing in a bunch of cameos from their other library of media.
It's almost as if that's literally the criticism this segment is dedicated to, or something.
Really? Are you seriously complaining about this stuff? Again, and I will say this, it's a kid's movie. Of course they're gonna put in some stuff to advertise their other product. What did you expect? A high quality story? No! This is Space Jam. Not a high quality story like Kingdom Hearts or whatever I can think of that's on the top of my head.
Zesty, you can't just dismiss every criticism Misanthro has of the movie with, it's a kid's film though. Just because it's a kid's film doesn't mean it intrinsically has to be a shameless cash grab that shoves other intellectual properties into the faces of its audience. This dismissal of critique gets especially annoying when I can literally point to a plethora of examples of that not being the case. Most Disney animated movies would immediately come to mind. See the likes of Soul, Frozen, Coco, Moana, Up. Like, this dismissal just doesn't work on any level as a form of counter-critique or debate at Misanthro's criticism here. Furthermore, are you really gonna be sitting here and acting like it'd be okay for Warner to advertise It, Game of Thrones, and Clockwork Orange to an audience of specifically children? Because if so, never be on a marketing team. Oh yeah, and let's not merely ignore how your example of something that wouldn't do this kind of shameless advertising of other intellectual properties is Kingdom fucking Hearts.
I mean, the original Space Jam was shameless corporate garbage too, but it wasn't nearly as bad as it is here. This movie is somehow an even worse commercial than the original Space Jam. And I might have been willing to overlook this because it's Space Jam and I should have expected this to happen going into the movie, but it's because of how badly Warner Brothers is just jerking themselves off to this stuff.
Oh! And Misanthropony even addresses the you should expect this from Space Jam garbage by explaining how much worse the sequel is to its predecessor.
Every single second of this movie is Warner Brothers saying, hey folks, are you a fan of all these properties we're desperately trying to force into the movie? Then why not subscribe to HBO Max? Only $14.99 a month for the rest of your life. First one's free. The basketball game is definitely the worst of it, as your attention is constantly being distracted by all of the stupid Easter eggs they shoved into this film. It's extremely overcrowded and ugly to look at. You know the jokes that people have been making about this movie trying to be like Ready Player One when the trailer first came out? Yeah, that's exactly what it is. They wanted to be like Ready Player One, but didn't bother to hire Spielberg to consult how to incorporate a background universe of characters. They just looked at the concept they came up with and said, fuck it.
Let's just throw a bunch of stuff on screen to get stupid people's attention because we're referencing all sorts of classic and popular IPs instead of creating something good. Because as bad writers, we're incapable of doing so.
Map, this is why I do not respect you now. You are basically pinning the blame on the writers for being, well, just that, bad writers. You have to keep in mind, are human, much like us. They're gonna make mistakes, and no writer is perfect after all.
You've lost all respect for Misanthropony for saying bad writers are bad writers. I know I'm not missing anything here. That's deadass your point, and, like... But why, though? Like, Misanthro isn't even saying that these writers are bad people, just that they're bad writers. Something that you're even continuing to call them in your interjection only to write that off because they're human and will make mistakes, which is another point of dismissal. Like, yeah, not every writer is going to be perfect. It's almost as if that's what Misanthroponi is critiquing. The writing. He sees all of this product placement as shoved in without a care to in-depth world-building, whereas he feels they could have used these other intellectual properties to make something coherent, using Ready Player One as an example of this being done right. Now, I would say he's wrong myself, personally. Like, especially in the basketball scene, I didn't really find myself actively looking for Easter eggs to other IPs. All of the important movement is framed in a way where your eyes are expected to stay on the action, and the Easter eggs are only really there to add detail more than anything else. Plus, I could make the argument that showing these IPs in of themselves can be a form of world building, considering the Serververse is an archive of Warner properties in a Warner studio. I think Misanthro might have forgotten that detail, so like, I don't even think there wasn't the ability to make a valid point against him here, but dismissing it because the writers aren't perfect isn't productive, especially since I doubt he's expecting them to be such.
You have to understand that. You can't just pin everything on the writers for not putting out something good and high quality like you want them. It's not always going to be that way, and you should know.
Can I just write off Zesty's whole commentary with, oh, but Misanthroponi is a human and is gonna make mistakes, or do you think that'd be too on the nose at this point in time?
Easter eggs are supposed to be a small thing in the background you didn't notice during your first viewing. It's supposed to be a tiny clue you notice over time so you can congratulate yourself for finding it later. They're not supposed to be painfully obvious. They're not supposed to be all over the foreground for everyone to see.
He says, as he shows an image of these Easter eggs being in the background after Gossamer was set ablaze. Look, if Zesty is going to spend their time sidestepping every point, I need something of substance to cover here.
And they're not supposed to supersede the actual movie. It astounds me how Warner Brothers is so shameless and made no attempt to hide their corporate shilling in this film. Hell, they even got E3 involved in this mess. How much money do you think E3 was willing to pay to make an appearance in a fucking Space Jam movie?
Do you have no humility? Do you have no shame? Do you have any idea how to make a movie without shoving product placement in our faces? What in God's name is wrong with you?
Calm down, it's just a kid's movie. It's not the end of the world because a movie decided to put in a bunch of product placements in there as advertisement. And I'm just gonna end the video there because honestly, I do not feel like covering the rest of it. And let's be real, I don't think anyone would want to cover the rest of Map's videos after seeing this garbage.
Bro, you literally avoided the last three goddamn points Misanthro made because it kids film. I don't want to hear you get this aggressive in response.
So, overall, Map, I'm disappointed. This was not a very good review. You went into this movie expecting it to have high quality writing when you should have known well that the Space Jam sequel was going to be a kid's movie with no high quality writing whatsoever. And don't get me started on what you've been doing on Twitter lately. If anyone wants any information on what I'm talking about, I'll leave a link down below where you can check out a video on Map's recent behavior on Twitter. As the user in question, heck, goes into far more detail than I have time to go over.
And there's the other shoe. Oh yeah, if you thought a video as subpar as what we've been shown having this much of a visceral reaction to it was a little fishy, you weren't alone. Zesty was absolutely building this whole video on misplaced spite towards unrelated actions that Misanthro took on the hell site we know as Twitter. Specifically, the actions talked about by MPS the Shark. These actions include deleting comments that apparently were only out to start arguments, sometimes being immature on this platform by leaving his own rude comments on other people's videos, blocking other YouTubers who already showed them that they don't like him, and ultimately is just kind of unpleasant online sometimes, as well as making subjectively bad videos at an inconsistent rate, with that complaint boiling down to making videos that are longer than MTS subjectively thinks they should be, ignoring the content within those videos, making trailers that MTS thinks is unnecessary to reviews Misanthro's audience might be looking forward to, and using language that's, yeah, pretty offensive. I definitely have my own qualms with MTS's video, primarily how spite-driven it seemed to be over what were ultimately minute scuffs over how negatively both acted towards ultimately subpar content, and the weird contradictory opinions scattered throughout about just how much MTS hated Misanthro, the mostly unsubstantiated and assuming claims littered throughout the video, a chunk of them feeling like hyperbole at best, plus MTS's complaints that Misanthro's content is horribly subjective and pretty arbitrary at the best of times, and ripe with double standards and blatant assumptions at the worst of times. There's also a lot of abhorrent repetition throughout the video, and it's obviously made in very bad faith as MTS throws label after label on Misanthro and assumes the worst of his actions. Like, MTS's video is, in of itself, commentary material, but like, I really don't want to make another hour-long commentary at the moment. I've got other projects I want to get done before the end of October, so I'm just gonna leave it at that. This time. That said, while Misanthro does come across as pretty unpleasant and rude in all of these other instances, being unpleasant and rude towards him in a video that's ultimately flippant in nature is pretty reductionist, especially when hardly any of your counterpoints were valid and were instead, it kids film.
Overall, Map, if I could say something, I know you're watching this. I know you're just going to write me off as some hater, even though I kindly critiqued your work.
Hey, that's the best joke in this video.
And honestly, I know what's going to happen. And if you do leave a comment criticizing me, it's just gonna prove my point. You cannot respect people's opinions.
Look, I've never agreed with the notion that doing a commentary on someone's subjective-based video is disrespecting an opinion or being unable to handle opposing viewpoints. However, if we were to go off of this belief that you show you stand behind here, then aren't you doing a commentary on someone's subjective stance on Space Jam 2? Like, let us not forget who started this chain, Zesty.
Honestly, if I can say this to you, grow up and stop attacking people over stupid and petty reasons, and try to have a normal discussion like an adult for once in your life.
And we end the video off with that, I guess. What a fucking gamer. Final thoughts. Well, I'm not sure what more I can add to this video. This was a spitefully dismissive commentary on someone you obviously have a clear bias against, coming from the testimony of someone else who has a clear bias against that very same person. And while contrary to the popular belief, spite-driven commentaries can work, there's kind of an art to it that requires you to still give a rat's ass about the subject matter you're discussing, to which it's quite clear you did not have here. You would rather act as if Misanthroponi's critiques are wildly unorthodox and absurdly overreactionary so you can skirt around his points rather than address them head-on. And it winds up making this video feel like it was made in bad faith, which ironically is the same kind of criticisms I can lob at what I saw of Misanthroponi and MTS the Shark. Like, is this really the new standard for media critique? Because I don't like it. It's unreasonably harsh and tactless and is exactly the reason why I typically refuse to do commentaries on those I dislike, as it leads you to reach for more problems with an individual than are really necessary to the video. Like, I'm not even sure what advice I could give to all three of you that's not just, don't do this, or if you are going to, actually care enough about the topic you're discussing to where you don't feel like just shouting down your opposition with judgmental insults or bullshit, I hate you, get off the internet rhetoric. Focus on the points more than the person, please. I'm just gonna end the video here. Have a good one, I guess. So, you're not brainwashed? No, Mistress wasn't able to brainwash me. She just removed the filter between my brain and my mouth. So, back there, when the shackles were on me, yeah, that was me unfiltered. So you honestly believed that me having these shackles is better? Better than me having them? Oh, for fucking sure, don't get me wrong. You're still my commentary buddy, and I'll see you through till you stop, but fuck, the idea that that could be me in those shackles? Yeah, not for me, Chief.
I see.
Hey, Ginger, Z, where are we even? I don't recognize this part of the ship. This is an unused part of the ship that needed to be quarantined from a gas leak. Why are we going through it now? Because the rest of the ship is currently overrun by Little and her crew, and this half of the ship runs off a different generator, which we'll need in order to travel the Squalor's dimension. Just try to keep your breathing slow, the gas is fairly toxic. But the less you breathe in, the less it'll harm you.